Acts 18, and we read from verse 1. If you are there, you say amen. 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 After this, Paul left Athens and went to Corinth, and he found a Jew named Aquila, a native of Pontus. Recently came from Italy with his wife Priscilla, because Claudius had commanded all the Jews to leave Rome. And he went to see them, and because he was of the same trade, he stayed with them and worked, for they were tent makers by trade. And he reasoned in the synagogue every Sabbath and tried to persuade Jews and Greeks. When Silas and Timothy arrived from Macedonia, Paul was occupied with the word, testified to the Jews that the Christ was Jesus. And when they opposed and reviled him, he took out his garments and said to him, "Your blood be on your heads. I am innocent. From now on, I will go to the Gentiles." And he left there and went to the house of a man named Titus, Justus, a worshiper of God. His house was next door to the synagogue. Crispus, the ruler of the synagogue, believed in the Lord together with his entire household. And many of the Corinthians, hearing Paul, believed and were baptized. And the Lord said to Paul one night in a vision, "Do not be afraid, but go on speaking and do not be silent. For I am with you, and no one will attack you to harm you. For I have many in this city who are my people." And he stayed a year and 6 months teaching the word of God among them. But when Gallio was proconsul of Achaia, the Jews made an united attack on Paul and brought him before the tribunal, saying, "This man is persuading people to worship God contrary to the law." But when Paul was about to open his mouth, Gallio said to the Jews, "If it were a matter of wrongdoing or officious crime, O Jews, I would have reason to accept your complaint. But since it's a matter of questions about words and names and your own law, see to it yourselves. I refuse to be a judge of these things." And he drove them from the tribunal, and they all seized Sothenes, the ruler of synagogue, and beat him in front of tribunal. But Gallio paid no attention to any of this. After this, Paul stayed many days longer than they took leave of the brothers, and set sail for Syria. And with him Priscilla and Aquila. At Cenchrea he had cut his hair, for he was at a vow. And they came to Ephesus, and he left them there, but he himself went into the synagogue and reasoned with the Jews. When they asked him to stay for a longer period, he declined. But on taking leave of them, he said, "I will return to you if God wills." And he set sail from Ephesus. When he had landed at Caesarea, he went up and greeted the church, and then went down to Antioch. After spending some time there, he departed and went from one place to the next through the region of Galatia, Phrygia, strengthening all the disciples. Now a Jew named Apollos, a native to Alexandria, came to Ephesus. He was an eloquent man, competent in the scriptures. He had been instructed in the way of the Lord. And being fervent in spirit, he spoke and taught accurately the things concerning Jesus. Though he knew only the baptism of John, he began to speak boldly in the synagogue. But when Priscilla and Aquila heard him, they took him and explained to him the way of God more accurately. And when he wished to cross to Achaia, and brothers encouraged him and wrote to the disciples to welcome him. When he arrived, he greatly helped those who through grace believed, for he powerfully refuted Jews in public, showing by the scriptures that Christ was Jesus. And Lord, we honor you. We ask you in Jesus' name, the Lord, you may break down your word to a level of our understanding. We ask you, Holy Spirit of God, you may whisper in the ear of each one of us and give us understanding of your word. We ask you for the revelation of your word. We ask you for the lema part of your word that we may receive it today and may it transform our lives. Lord, anoint me afresh with the spirit of God, the anointing of the spirit of God, that may lightly divide your word according to your perfect will. In Jesus' name, somebody shout amen. Somebody shout amen. And Paul is this missionary. He's a missionary. He's moving from one town to another. And this time in Acts 18, he moves from Athens, where we left him last time, and now he is in Corinth. And the Bible says in Corinth, he comes and dwells with one couple, that is Priscilla and Aquila, because Claudius, the ruler of that time, had instructed and had commanded all Jews to leave Rome. So Priscilla and Aquila are like refugees in Corinth because they had just moved from Rome. And Paul stayed with them and he worked with them. The Bible says Priscilla and Aquila were tent makers, and also Paul was a tent maker. So Paul, Priscilla, and Aquila, they continue making tents. But the Bible says every Sabbath, Paul used to go to the synagogue and reason with the Jews. And the Bible says the reasoning was so effective, so many people believed. And this caused people to rise against Paul. You see, Paul is this kind of a man, wherever he went, he did not care what other people felt like. Wherever he went, he knew he was in a mission of God. So any city he entered and started sharing the gospel. Corinth was not a good city. It was a city full of immorality. In fact, they had a goddess of immorality. So there were some temples in Corinth. People used to commit immorality with temple prostitutes. So Corinth was not that godly city. Nevertheless, Paul, when he entered, he continued doing tent making, sharing the word, and refuting what these people were doing in their temples. And this attracted a lot of attacks on this Paul. And the Bible says, the Lord appeared to him in night through a vision, and he told him, Paul, don't you be silenced by any person. Don't you be afraid. Continue speaking my message. I am with you. None of these people will hurt you. And I am with you. I will never leave you. And my dear, I have so many people who belong to me in this city. Because Paul was of the opinion, I'm the only person sharing the gospel here. But God reveals to him, in this city, I have so many people. And because of that, there's a lot of movements. I beseech us to be tentative. Praise be to Jesus. Yeah, we don't want you to interrupt those who are listening. So just take your time. Praise be to Jesus. And Paul is refuted by the Lord. In this city, there are a lot of people who believe in me. And they go ahead and even take Paul to the governor of the city, a man called Gallio. And the scripture says Gallio had no time to listen to these Jews. He told these Jews, the matter you are bringing before me about who should be worshipped, what this man is preaching, is not a matter in my jurisdiction. So I will not listen to it. So you Jews, go among us yourself and sort your matters off. And he dispersed them off shamefully, and he did not listen to the case against Paul. And Paul went on preaching the gospel. And the Bible says he sails from Corinth and he goes to Ephesus. And when he goes to Ephesus, he goes with the same couple, Aquilas and Priscilla. And in Ephesus, they leave Aquilas and Priscilla in Ephesus to take care of the church there. And the Bible says a young man called Apollos appeared in Ephesus, and he was from Alexandria. Alexandria was in Egypt. And he came to Ephesus and started ministering the word of God. And the Bible says he was full of the Spirit, and he knew the word of God. The problem with him, he only knew the gospel according to John the Baptist. So all he preached was about baptism, and John the Baptist, the repentance. And Aquila and Priscilla call this young man and tell them, young man, just come. They realize he is anointed of God. He have a calling of God, and they sit with him, and they instructing lightly about the word of God. And after that, this man Apollos feel like going to Achaia, another city, and Aquilas and the brethren encourage him, they bless him, they strengthen him, and they set him off. Praise be to Jesus. Tent making. Somebody say tent making. You see, the issue of tent making is one of the issues that is very controversial. In fact, I went to a nation somewhere. And in that nation, I heard some pastor saying, one of the reasons as to why the gospel is not going on well is because some pastors are still doing other jobs. And the issue of tent making is a controversial issue. But we would like to look at it, how the Bible puts it. The Bible says when Paul arrives in Corinth, he did not become a burden to any person. He is hosted by Aquilas and Priscilla. And despite the fact that they are hosting him, he still works with his own hands in the tent making business, because he was a tent maker. Tent making was simply putting together cloths, that is tents, that is hides of animals, and making tents. And these tents used to be sold to Roman soldiers. Remember, this was a Roman empire. They had a lot of soldiers. So soldiers moved from one place to another. So they used to buy this tent and they become shelter. So Paul was very good in it. And through that, he earned his livelihood. And he did not become a burden to any person. And I want to encourage each one of us who is a believer, who is a minister. I would like to encourage you and tell you, you must be having a tent making thing, you know. And some of us, we have our own tent making thing God has given us, but we look down upon it. We think it's so small. Paul was so much learned. Despite that, he had something he was doing with his hands. And that's very important for believers to know. You know, some of us, we are called by God. And since we are called by God, we want to lord over people. We want to be burdens to people. We don't want to work with our own hands. But this man, Paul, was a tent maker. And he used to make tents. Somebody said he used to make tents. So there's no business of I being a pastor and all I'm expecting is you bring your things and I live with them. It's very biblical. Some people will take me to the book of the Old Testament about Levites who used to receive offering and tithes. But I will tell you, we are in a new other dispensation. Somebody say we are in a new dispensation. In this dispensation, we don't have to lord over people. We don't have to be burdens on people. God have blessed us. If you have any tent making God have given you, go ahead and do it with diligence. Somebody say, do it with diligence. And because of this, I'll tell you the truth. Wherever Paul went, he had no control. Nobody could manipulate him. Nobody could coerce him to say what they want. Paul, wherever he went, he preached the gospel. Why? One reason being, nobody was paying his bills. Well, nobody was paying his bills. So some of us, we are in ministry, but because some people are paying our bills, we cannot preach the gospel the way it is. Paradventure, we offered our donors. Paradventure, we offered a rich believer who supports the church. Praise be to Jesus. Ministers of the word of God, if God have blessed us with some tent making, do it with diligence and know it is from God. Even in our personal lives, the dads we have, the men we have, the women we have in the house of God, ensure you are doing something. If the man of God, an apostle, was doing something in his life, who are you to say, I will not do anything? Praise be to Jesus. You see, it is not of great significance whether it's a big thing or a small thing. The bottom line, God have blessed each one of us with some kind of tent making. Is it a smaller business? Handle it with care, with diligence, because it may be God's way of ensuring you have a tent-making thing in your life. Is it a big business? Handle it with a lot of care, because whether it's big or small, it could be God's way of ensuring that you go on with life well without being a burden to anyone. Praise be to Jesus. Though he was a tent-maker, he was mostly preoccupied with preaching. This is the point. Paul was not just doing tent making the whole day, the whole week. The Bible says on Sabbath, he used to go to synagogue and listen with these Jews. And this is the point. Any tent making we have in our lives, it should be a platform for us to minister. It should be a springboard to help us to minister. Some of us, we have tent making in our lives, and those tent making becomes the reason as to why we should not minister. Some of us, God have blessed us, and because he have blessed us, the tent making itself become a goddess in our lives, and we have no time for God. So tent making God have given us have become another block, blocking us from being ministers of the word of God. Bible says, every Sabbath, somebody say every Sabbath. Paul used to go to the synagogue and he listened with these people. Meaning, if I am a teacher, if I'm a doctor, if I'm an engineer, if I am anything God have made me to be, I should not think it's too big and block me from going in the presence of God. Praise be to Jesus. We must always have time off our tent making and find ourselves in the house of God. We must always have time of this tent making the business and go and listen with some Jews. Who are Jews? Jews had not believed there is Jesus. They just believed Jesus was any other prophet. They knew he came and he went. They just thought he's any other. And there are people here in this world who know there is Jesus. Yes, they know there is Jesus. But they don't know him as their Lord and Savior. They know there is Jesus in the context he is written in the Bible. They know there is Jesus in the context that some people on Saturday they go and worship him. But they have not come to a personal relationship with this Jesus. You must take time off your tent making to go to those people and tell them, Jesus is not any other person. He should have a personal relationship with you. And that was the business of Paul in Sabbath. He used to go and tell people, this Jesus is the Christ, the anointed of God. This Jesus is the Christ, the Messiah, the Savior. Praise be to Jesus. How many of us take time off our tent making to tell people that Jesus is Messiah? Or do we preoccupy ourselves with the tent making? Do we preoccupy ourselves with studies all along the week, all along the year? And at no given time do we find time to tell people, this Jesus is the Messiah. He should save you. Somebody say amen. Somebody shout amen. And when we start doing this, I'm telling you the truth, there will be revival in this nation. Any person in a career, any person in a business, any person doing something with their hands, if they take them, those things as platform to go and even minister, they'll be revival in this nation. Somebody shout amen. The minister should also work with their own heads for their own upkeep. Somebody shout amen. God blesses the work of our heads. If an apostle like Paul, very anointed, who were commissioned by Jesus himself, by light from heaven striking him to a point he could not see anything anymore, could still use his hands to do something to earn a living. I want to submit to each one of us. Yes, you come to church, we pray for you so that you may be blessed, but God will bless the work of your heads. Somebody shout amen. You know, at times you come to church and we preach heresies. We don't want to tell you, yes, God will bless you, but how will he do it? If you have something you can do with your heads, do it. And God will bless that. Paul could not just sit and say, I'm anointed of God. God, I ask you, like you did in the times of Moses, laying manna in this table. Did he do that? With Aquilas, with Priscilla, they joined heads and they made tents. And these tents were sold to Roman soldiers. And that's how Paul, in the land of Corinth, he earned his daily bread. The gospel must be preached in all places, in the marketplace, in the churches. This is the point. This gospel should not just be limited to the pastors. Hallelujah. This gospel should not just be limited to the apostles. This gospel is not limited to the evangelists and the teachers and the last and the prophets. This gospel is to be preached But any person, starting with those with tent-making businesses, starting with those in careers, starting with those in businesses, they should be part and parcel of the gospel. Somebody shout amen. You know, we have this mentality. This thing is for those who are called, those who are ordained, those who are done to do what, those who have big crowds. This gospel must be preached by any Christian. As long as there is something you do with your own hands, you should know there is another responsibility God has given you to preach and minister. Praise be to Jesus. Don't be so much preoccupied with your tent making and forget out of your tent making you should go and minister. And I always encourage, we need your money to support ministry. But you are more important than your money. Somebody shout amen. You are more important than what? Somebody say, I am more important than my money. You see, one of the deceptions of the enemy is that those in businesses and those in professions, the only thing they are supposed to do for the gospel to go on is to give their tithes and their offering. And that is good and continue doing it. But you are more than important than your money. This is the point. After the tent-making business, Paul used to go to the synagogue in person. He did not say, out of this tent making, let me go and give to the synagogue keeper, and he drove the ministry. He himself used to go to the synagogue and minister and listen with these Jews. This is the point. More than your money, come in person and minister to those people. More than your money, open your mouth and tell somebody, Jesus is the Messiah. More than your money, knock on a door and tell somebody, Jesus loves you. This is the point. More than your money, you also need to give your time. Somebody says time. Somebody shout time. More than your money, God needs your time. And one of the deceptions we have is that we preoccupy ourselves so much with our business and we flourish and we do well in our careers, but we have no time for God. And more than your money, God need your time. God need you to say, on Saturday, I will not go to this job. Because on Saturday, I need to go and visit my colleague and know how they are doing in their lives. On Saturday, on Sunday, I will need to go and witness. On weekday, in the evening, I will have some 30 minutes of my work so that the last customer who will visit me, I'll ask them something about their life and tell them, thank you for being my customer and promoting my business. But I have something more worthy than the products I sell you. In my heart, I have Jesus. And you still need this Jesus. More than your money, God needs you in the person. God needs your time. Somebody say, God needs my time. Somebody shout, God needs my time. Ministry will not go on by Skype. Ministry will not go on by Facebooking and by texting and by calling. That is not good enough. God needs us in person. God needs us in person. Somebody say, God needs me in person. So this is mentality of thinking. Somebody is, they are doing it. Let's learn from Paul. He himself on Sabbath left his tent making and was found in the synagogue doing the work of God. And the Bible says this man Paul met a lot of challenges. And it's very important to realize, as even you purpose to do the business and also you purpose also to be found in person doing the work of God, there is bound to be challenges and there are also bound to be successes. And the Bible says the first thing that happened, that these Jews opposed themselves and abused Paul. They did what? They opposed themselves. Some versions say these people opposed Paul. Not really. The right translation should be these Jews opposed themselves and abused who? Paul. You know, at times when men of God are opposed, they think they are being opposed. No, it's not your problem. Those people are opposing who? Themselves. Somebody said they are opposing themselves. You see, if something is true, you cannot oppose it. It can only be you dealing with your own issues. And the Jews opposed themselves. And what did they do? They reviled Paul. They abused Paul. And the Bible says, why were they so opposing themselves? Simply because some of the people in Corinth had believed, had become followers of Jesus. And because of that, they opposed themselves and they reviled against Paul. And the Bible says, Paul told them, your blood is upon your head. It's like, I'm done with you. It's like what Christ said, if you enter a city and they don't receive you on their gate, go and dust off your dust. Paul is doing a similar thing here. They have opposed him, they have opposed themselves, and he is done with their blood. And he says, your blood shall not be asked from my head, but it is upon your head. You will take personal responsibility of your own rebellion. And this is the point. Do your part as a minister of the word of God. Do your part by witnessing to your friend. And I'll tell you what, some will believe. Some will do what? Will believe. Because the Bible says in calling, the many believed. Yet, some will even tell you, are you an idolater? You know, we have gone for door-to-doors and you have heard things like, don't you have something else you can do? We have gone for door-to-doors and we have heard something like, are you calling us into your business? Yeah, the church business. So those are people who oppose themselves. And Bible says, preach to them, but then after doing it, it's upon them. They will be the one who asked their own blood. You are not the one to be asked. That means if after preaching to them, they are the one who will take their personal responsibility. It also means also, if I have somebody in my life who comes to me and they don't know Christ, and I shy away from sharing this Christ, somehow I'll be asked a question. If after sharing with them, that's when Paul is saying, now your blood will be asked from your own head. It means if Paul continued on with his tent making and the life in calling became very sweet and he never shared the gospel with these people, somehow God of heaven could one day ask Paul, what did you do with Corinthians that I brought in your life? And it's very sad for us to reach to that point when God will ask us, what did you do with your roommate that I brought to your life 4 years? What did you do with your neighbor in your house that I brought in your life for 5 years? It's very sad when God will one day ask us such big questions. Blessed are us if one day God will ask us that question. We'll answer God. God asked their blood from their own head because I shared the gospel with them. Because I did my part. And when these challenges come, I thank God. Because God appears to Paul at night through a vision. And he tells him, don't you be afraid. And this is a word we should take seriously. Those of us who have given our lives to ministry, those who are doing their tent making, and yet they find themselves also ministering, this is the encouragement. God is with us. Somebody say, God is with us. Somebody say, God is with me. You know, it doesn't matter how many people have joined together against you. As long as God is with you, you are good to go. Somebody say, I'm good to go. As long as God is on my side, I'm on the majority side. Even if the whole nation gang against you, even if the whole city, Collins, gang against Paul, as long as God have assured Paul, I am with you, he is good to go. And surely God was with him. Because when they brought him to Gario, the governor of the land, he shamefully tell them, I will not listen to this case. For a very simple reason. Very simple reason. Matters of worship. Matters of the law. Which law? The law of Moses. You know, Romans, we are not from Abrahamic lineage. So Gallio is not understanding. Why are you telling me about law? Law of who? Moses. So what should I do about it? And he said to them, I have nothing against this man. Go and sort your problem amongst yourself. Why did it happen like that? Because God was with Paul. God was with who? Paul. And when God is with you, even if there are a lot of planning, a lot of exaggeration on your case, God will start with you and he will spell off your enemies shame-free, because God was with Paul. So don't you be afraid ministering. Some of you may go like, oh, these people will think that I'm not well behaved, so we want to keep our manners and not share the gospel. These people will think I'm not civilized, so you want to be civilized and then not share the gospel. These people will think I'm not professional, so you want to remain professional so that you may not preach. Oh, these people will think I am lonely, so you want to remain relevant so that you may not preach the gospel. Bible says, God assured Paul, I am with you. Somebody say, I am with you. And anytime we are going through challenges, always remember God's promise to us, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. The Bible says in the book of Matthew, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. I'll be with you till the closure of ages. So those of us who step in to say we'll do business and yet minister, God is still with us. Somebody shout amen. Amen. What is one reason that God can have to ensure that he is with you? Ask yourself, that is a very simple question. What is that one reason? What is that one reason that will make God say and resolve, I am with this person? Let me give you a very good reason. A very good reason to ensure that God is always with you. Be found sharing about his son. Be found advancing issues of his kingdom. Be found introducing people to his kingdom. And one thing God will resolve, I'll never leave this person. I'll never leave this person. And the Bible says, in Ephesus, Paul moves with Aquilas and Priscilla. And he leaves them there, depicting one thing that is very important. This work of God, we are not to do it like our own shop, our own business, our own empire. This work of God, we are supposed to raise co-workers. Somebody say co-workers. Somebody shout co-workers. This work of God is supposed to be done by us and the people God is bringing up. It is not meant to be done by one person alone. This work of God is meant to be done by ministers, and they should be confident to leave some of the work to other co-workers, because alone they cannot make it. And the Bible says in Ephesus, the same couple that hosted Paul in Corinth, he leaves them in Ephesus, and these people take care of God's work in Ephesus. And in Ephesus, this man, young man, comes up called Apollos from Alexandria. And this man was, let's say he was anointed. Let's say he was learned. Because Alexandria, there was one of the biggest universities was in Alexandria in Egypt. Even up today, there's a very center of education, university in Alexandria. So in Alexandria, Apollos was brought up in Alexandria. So if we were to speak about a learned person, he was learned. If we were to talk about a good orator, somebody who could speak well and address a congregation, it was Apollos. And the scripture says, when Apollos comes to Ephesus, he was in Ephesus preaching the gospel, and he could move the crowd. The only problem with this young man was that he knew just John the Baptist and the repentance. And I want to say it like this. There is a place for discipleship. There is a place for being raised, like what Aquilas and Priscilla do to Apollos. Aquilas and Priscilla identify this man, there's something good in him. He will go very far. And this woman, Priscilla and Aquilas, they can see it. And the church must be like that. The church of God must be a place whereby people can see where people are going. People can identify this talent, this gifting, this calling in this person. The church should not be a place whereby somebody with a calling, with a gifting is pressed down. The church should be a place whereby somebody with a calling, with a gifting, they are lifted. Somebody say they are lifted. And Aquilas and Priscilla noticed Apollos, there's something good about him, and they call him. And what did they do to him? They called him, and they invited him to their home. They explained the way of God more accurately. They explained what? The way of God more accurately. And what did they explain to him? They explained to him the ways of salvation. Somebody say salvation. That is repentance that comes after receiving Christ as personal Savior. They explained to him the ways of God. What does that mean? The issue of the Holy Spirit, the workings of the Holy Spirit, the giftings of the Holy Spirit, and they explained to him the calling of God and how it should be handled. And not this one thing about Apollos. Even before Priscilla and Aquila called him, the Bible records he explained scriptures accurately. So Apollos was not a novice, was not a starter, was still good somehow, but he needed Priscilla and Aquila to explain to him the ways of God. Somebody say the ways of God. One of the purposes of a local church, it should be a place where the ways of God are accurately and in details explained to the people of God so that they may know the ways of God. One of the mystics, I can call it a mystic, we have in the church, it's majoring on one thing in the scripture. Majoring on just one thing in the scripture. Apollos could move crowds. Apollos could attract many people. Yet he was just preaching John the Baptist and repentance alone. John the Baptist and the repentance alone. He did not know anything further than that. And it's upon the local church to know this word of God must be preached wholesomely. Somebody say wholesomely. Somebody shout wholesomely. It means there's no place in the house of God just to say this is the way we do things, and it becomes the alone way we do things, the only way we do things. Right now, there's a lot of Pentecostalism, and I honor men and women of God who started the move of Pentecostalism. And most of the churches are Pentecostal. And it is good and it is powerful. Somebody say it is good. Somebody say it's powerful. But besides that, the church must always take the word wholesomely. It must not just be about the speaking in tongues alone. It must not just be about the giftings of the Holy Spirit alone. It must not just be about the baptism alone. The word of God must be preached wholesomely. Somebody say wholesomely. And you see, if a man of God just takes one bit of the scripture and he just dwells on that alone, there's a limitation. Somebody say there is a limitation. Somebody shout there's a limitation. If a local church, they just embrace one part of the scripture alone, let's say Pentecostalism, and we embrace that alone, there will be a limitation. There will be a what? And Priscilla and Aquilas, they realize, Apollos, you may not go very far. Because if you just dwell on the scripture, John the Baptist, and repentance, you are not going very far. And that's why it's important to sit and be taught the ways of God. Because once we start seeing the ways of God, the limitations is removed. Somebody say limitation is removed. And after Paul, Aquilas and Priscilla explained to him the ways of the Lord, don't just say about John the Baptist, say about Jesus. Say about how he came, he died. Say about the Holy Spirit, how he filled the church. Say about fivefold ministry. Say about the kingdom of God, not just our church. Say about the kingdom of God. Say about the hope of glory. Say about the things God has kept for us. Remove the limitations. And the Bible says after that, Apollos felt like going to Achaia, another city. And the same brethren, the same people encouraged him. They strengthened him and they blessed him. And the Bible says he goes to Achaia, another city. And in that city, scripture is very clear that in that city, Apollos powerfully refuted the Jews in public, showing the scriptures that Christ is Jesus, that Christ is Messiah. The man who came to Ephesus, just talking about John the Baptist, only. Just talking about repentance only, after he is instructed well by Aquilas and Priscilla, now his calling enlarges and he has to move to another city. And do you know what? When he moved to that other city, he is no longer talking about John and his repentance and baptism. He's now talking about Jesus, the Messiah, the Savior of the world. And he does not say it in secretly. The scripture says he publicly and powerfully refuted the Jews. Refuted the Jews. Why? These Jews say this Jesus, but he is not the Messiah. And Apollos now in a city, a new city, in public, he powerfully refuted the Jews and told them clearly, Jesus is Messiah. That's what happens when we allow ourselves to be instructed in the ways of the Lord. The limitations are broken and we move very far. Somebody say limitations are broken. Where we know the ways of the Lord. And the church is supposed to be such a place. A place whereby a sister comes in. A place whereby a brother comes in. And all they know that God provides the daily bread. And God heals. And that is all they know about Jesus. And that is all they want about Jesus. A church should be a place whereby when they come in, we tell them, it's true, Jesus gives land. Jesus gives the daily bread. Jesus gives the clothing. Jesus pays the school fees. Besides that, there's a lot of other things that Jesus does. And by explaining to them the ways of the Lord, we break limitations in their lives. Somebody say, breaking limitations. And it happens when we allow ourselves to be instructed. Somebody say, to be instructed in the ways of the Lord. To be instructed is not to be soothed. To be instructed is simply instructed. Somebody say, it's instructed. Aquilas and Priscilla were not soothing Apollos. They were instructing him about the ways of the Lord. And so he moved to other cities. And dads and moms who are in this place, in those small families, let them be places that you will instruct people on the ways of the Lord. And you will take them to a higher level than where they are now. You will open their minds to greater things that God can do besides the only thing they know God can do. And by so doing, you will break limitations in their lives. And Lord, we honor your name.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new